Back in the studio, mate, and just in time for so much Doctor Who news.
Back once again with the podcast studio.
That's it, we're back. We've had so many remote recordings lately.
Two.
So two. It felt like a lot.
It did, didn't it? I haven't been in the studio for like 6 weeks. I finally got my charger back.
Yeah,
kind of. Torsi was here for 6 weeks.
It's just been sat here.
That was on the Sarah Jane review.
And then you forgot to pick it up the next time you were in. And then we had 2 weeks of not being in here.
Aiden just didn't take it to my house.
You know, I look simple. But I look like, I kept forgetting. I look like such an asshole in last week's episode. Do you know why?
Mm-mm.
Other than the usual.
No, I don't. Why? What did you do?
Because I slightly put the, for the first half of the episode, our tracks, with the remote recordings that we do, are recording on separate.
Yeah, it got fixed halfway through.
Yeah, I'm a little bit early in my side of the audio. And so there's like often some decent gaps before you talk, which is fine. It just sounds like internet stuff. But every time I start talking, it sounds like I'm cutting you off.
That's the thing. So that's how it kind of used to be, which was a nice little reminder of...
why we shouldn't do that?
I suppose. But yeah, it was kind of funny. And then like it got to the point in the edit where I think you were almost replying the second I finished talking. So it's like that didn't happen in real time. But Aiden's editing magic... kind of helped.
Well, no, I kind of fucked up the editing because I had the first half of my audio track coming in too early.
No one really watched that episode anyway.
Yeah, so it's fine. It's all good.
I don't think people really give a fuck about Sarah Jane Adventures reviews, which is sad.
We might have to have a rain check there, but we'll get to that one.
We will. But it's okay. And if there was ever an episode to kind of mess up on it, it was that one.
Well, if there's ever an episode to be back in the studio together for it, it's this one. With so much news, so much stuff coming up in today's episode.
News.
Connor, we've got new titles.
Mm-hmm.
We've got season one trailer.
Oh,
a new trailer, not
season,
the old one.
Season one trailer two.
That's it.
Yeah.
We're also going to ask a big question of, is Russell writing too many episodes? A lot of people are talking about that. And we are going to move on to our review of The Horror of Fang Rock to celebrate Doctor Who season 15 that has just been released and has made its way to Australian soils.
Soils. Australian soils.
Okay. I mean, it's not out in Australia. If you want it in Australia, you'll probably have to wait about a year and pay about $200 because every time these sets come out, they go up like $30.
Right. So you can't go into JB Hi-Fi and
No, they don't even have the last one out yet.
What?
The season 20, I think it was.
On the website?
No, right.
Are they just giving up?
I think they're just like, just don't give a fuck anymore.
Every time I go in there, I see the Sylvester McCoy one.
Yeah, they're like,
season
this,
23
this one didn't sell.
26.
20, I think 24. It's always that
it's
one, isn't it?
It's some Sylvester McCoy
poor
set.
Sylv, season 24
I'm just
sat there.
Just to buy it, just to give it a nice home.
Yeah, I'll give it a cuddle.
Give it a cuddle.
What would you do with it?
Probably eventually watch it.
Would you though?
I do want to get all these sets eventually.
You say that, but there's so many of them now.
Listen, motherfucker, okay? I will do it one day. You got to bear with me a little bit.
All right, I'll let you cook.
I do want some Doctor Who merchandise. Okay?
You do?
I was tempted to wear my scarf today. I have a knitted scarf.
I don't think it's quite scarf season just yet.
No. It's from my ex-girlfriend as well. Her mum did it, so I was like, I don't know if I want to wear it.
Mm.
But it's like... It would fit the episode well. I do have some Doctor Who memorabilia, and that is a cool thing to have. It's hand-knitted as well, and it's done really well. So I do have that. And, I'm sorry I'm not cool like you guys getting all your box sets.
Mm.
Maybe one day we'll have it.
Well, it's a stupid expensive thing. My shelves just have fucking grey down the sides of them now because of all these grey spines. But, you know, they're great sets.
Do they release one a year?
No, I do like 2 to 3 a year. It slowed down during COVID and it's not quite picked up since then. Or I think there was some like, this might be like me talking about Classic Who here where I just sort of make half of it up. I think I saw like they really slowed down at one point because the cases were manufactured in like Ukraine or was like somehow tied into like the Ukraine
war
conflict. Yeah.
Wow.
But I literally might just be making that up, so
they
don't
just blow up the Doctor Who collection.
They blew up, They blew up Nick Briggs' warehouse.
Yeah. My sets.
My big finishes.
Anyway, my sets.
Folks, follow us on Twitter.
I just love stories. What did I do?
Follow us on Twitter and Instagram @50Doctor. Follow us on TikTok @50Doctor Who. Subscribe on YouTube. Give us 5 stars on Spotify.
Yeah,
donate to us in the Ko-fi or hit that thanks button on YouTube.
Hit the thanks button.
And we're gonna have a fucking cracking show. Cheers.
Let's get into it. We're back,
baby.
Back
in the stew today.
Back in the stew.
Let's go.
50% podcast.
Oh, baby.
These are way too easy to drink.
What, the hard solos? It just, like,
it just tastes
solo.
Like pop.
Yeah. I'm drinking seltzer today, Good Tides. I've had them a couple times on the
podcast. I like them. It's got a cute whale on it.
Yeah, we like whales.
Good Tides. Good Tidings to you and your gin.
I'm having Good Tides, mate.
Good Tides.
Okay, Connor, I thought, talking about these new titles, to spice it up a little bit, because it's sort of old news by the time these titles will come out. But obviously, we have 8 brand new titles for season one.
Yeah.
I was quite drunk when these were coming out, and it was a lot of fun. I was just with my mate, having a little sesh down the pub at half
Easter
an hour.
Saturday?
Easter Sunday, I think.
Easter Sunday for us?
Yeah. And I was just checking these every half hour, and we were just sort of saying...
That was great, by the way. I loved the half hour drops.
Yeah, that was. Really, I hope they do fun. That again. That was good fun.
Good for engagement on Twitter. Got people talking instead of them all just dropping it at once. And then finally at the end, the trailer dropped. And
yeah.
It wasn't too late for us. I think it was like 12:30.
I think, yeah. I think it was about 1:30, actually.
Oh, crumbs, was it?
Yeah.
We're kind of night owls, to be fair.
Yeah, I remember. Cool. I sort of got home from being out at about... maybe 12:45.
Oh yeah, and I just put on Wild Blue Yonder, and
I didn't end up putting on Wild Blue Yonder
because
I was enjoying Twitter just exploding about space babies.
Oh, space!
So I never
babies.
Ended up putting on Wild Blue Yonder.
It's
but
you.
It's you.
It's
all right.
Huge.
So speaking of space babies, let's go through the titles.
Right.
But as we do this, Connor, we're going to introduce a little bit of a segment here. You're not going to see this one pop up probably until the new series come out. But I guess we're going to premiere this little segment here.
That's next month.
Called Upgrade or Delete.
Delete.
Upgrade in progress.
Oh, I like it.
Ooh, new sting.
That,
so no,
that sound is good.
You'll hear that again with a proper look into this segment when the new season comes out. But we're just going to like do a little trial run here. Basically, we're going to go through each one of these new titles, and we're going to say, do we want to upgrade it or delete it? Upgrade means it's good. Delete means it's bad.
Get
as simple
it.
As that.
Okay.
Right, and when down the line we want to get you guys to like throw in like your hot takes or just like random Doctor Who takes, and we'll upgrade or delete them. Are they good? Are they bad? We'll decide.
You know the rules.
You do. So, Connor, space babies, upgrade or delete?
Delete that shit.
Get that out of here.
Get the fuck out of here.
I don't even mind that it's got space babies in it. It's just like,
I do.
You know, when that new Disney Plus user is like, oh, I'm new to Doctor Who, and they see the title Space Babies for episode 1, they're like, what the fuck am I signing up for?
Yeah, Russell does like to take risks. Hey? It's like, do you know what's at stake, man?
A risk is a word for it. The Devil's Cord.
Oh, upgrade.
Instant upgrade, mate.
Beautiful, beautiful name.
It's so perfect, isn't it? It like sells like the vibe of it. It's kind of spooky.
The spook, yeah.
Like supernatural, I mean.
Yeah.
And obviously like music. It's a good use of the word chord.
The divine chord, yeah.
Okay. Boom! Without an exclamation mark.
Delete. Fucking boring as hell. How, what a stupid name.
Come I on. Thought it was stupid.
Yes.
Right? But I'm going to upgrade it purely because it's so Stephen Moffat in his one word titles, you know, like extremists. You got Blink.
Yeah.
World Enough and Time.
The Doctor Falls.
You know, I don't mind that one. I think there's worse titles in here. 73 Yards, upgrade for me.
Yeah, upgrade.
It's something spooky about it. I think it's the ident, though, that came out with it that I'm more intrigued by. Like the little dark...
It looks like a pub thing.
Yeah, pub banner.
Pub
73
banner.
Yards.
Yeah, that's an episode we don't really know much about, which has got me excited. I don't know if there's much in the trailer of it. The snowing scenes, I believe, are connected to that, but...
I don't fucking know, man.
I don't know.
I don't know, but yeah, two upgrades there. Dot and Bubble.
Episode
5.
Delete.
Get that shit out of here.
Dot and Bubble, come on.
Delete that shit.
Delete that shit. Mm-hmm. I don't know. It's like... You might watch the episode and be like, wow, it makes so much more sense now. What a great title, but I doubt it.
Yeah. Well, I did see... shout out to the Black Archives over on... Not the Black Archives, Bad Wolf Archives over on Twitter. But also shout out to the Black Archives because they are... That's where we get all our photos for the thumbnails from.
Lots of shout outs today.
But Bad Wolf Archives over on Twitter, they said... I think they went to like uni event or something like that where Russell was there. And like a month ago, Russell had said, watch out. They'd said to Russell, are we like Wobbly Yonder? And Russell had said, make sure you check out Dot and Bubble, but don't reveal the title until we've shown it. And so is Dot and Bubble going to be like Wobbly Yonder territory? Except the title's so much less cool than Wobbly Yonder. We've always said Wobbly Yonder was a cool title.
That's the coolest name.
Yeah.
It's like, you know how that Twitter guy had that... and then Farries has the Farries ramp.
Yeah.
when's Russell going to be like the pub in, what's it, 90 yards?
In 73 yards. Yeah,
the pub in 73 yards is inspired by
the studio.
The 50% .2 podcast, because they drink beers on their
show.
It's got
like our posters in the background of the pub and that.
We need that.
Me and you will be extras. We'll be the bartenders. Yeah,
you played a bartender in...
In one of my short films, I played a bartender.
So Let Me Be?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're the bartender. You're like, this is already in my CV. Yeah,
I can just send that to Russ and be like, hey, brother, anytime you're a bartender, I'll be there.
I can play the superstitious bartender.
He'll be like, oh, we're actually reshooting scenes from 73 yards as we speak. I'll fly you over, get you in. Yeah,
you can be like, you know, there's a myth in this town about
drugs.
There's a wolf going around.
People also, if you want some crack, I can give you some crack.
Definitely 73 yard shit.
Carly's crack. I mean, we'll before the new season comes out, we'll do like a full speculation episode, right?
Yeah.
Where we do all of our theories and things for the new season.
Yeah.
So we don't need to go diving too deep into here. But do you think this one will be spooky? And 73 yards. Yard is a very American word, right? It's not English. So could this be set in America? Is it a monster that's 73 yards?
Are we talking about 73 yards?
Yeah, just briefly, I guess.
I honestly, I have no idea. I think that's exciting. I think it's the episode with the TARDIS on the hillside. Uh-huh. I thought that was from Stephen Moffat's episode, and I made a big scene on here like, it's the Stephen Moffat episode. Apparently that's wrong, and I'm a fucking idiot, and everyone's laughing. I walk down the street and people point and laugh.
Connor Hannum is wrong.
I admit it. I admit defeat.
Never in my life.
So something happens to the TARDIS. I think we see Ruby just going, like, maybe she's there for a long, long time because we see the TARDIS
getting older. Yeah.
I assume because we don't see the Doctor in any of those scenes, it was the Stephen one because of the landmine. He can't move. But I don't know. I think that's the exciting thing, is that we don't know. And I think that's the scene where we see the three shots of Millie.
You know,
just wearing glasses in one with wine. I'm not sure if you saw that.
I did. Yeah, as I know. I'm a big fan of that look.
So it's like, yeah, I think it's that kind of... And that woman in the background who's like looking at Millie. I think it's that. Do I think it's going to be spooky? Yeah, I do.
Is the woman in the background 73 yards away? Let's just let that sit for a second.
I think it's Mrs. Flood.
Dot and bubble, delete or upgrade?
Delete.
Delete. Fuck that shit.
There is a fridge. You know the woman in the blonde woman in Dot and Bubble?
Yeah.
With like the headband?
Looks like Daphne.
No. There's a rumor that's Mrs. Flood because she also wears a thing on the head like that and she's blonde.
Fucking hell. Rogue. Upgrade or delete?
Delete.
Delete.
So boring.
It's grown on me.
Boring.
It's grown on me purely because I like the vibe of I like that Regency vibe.
I don't. That's literally the one I'm least excited for.
But and like Jonathan Groff's character looks cool.
I know Captain Jack Harkness is in it. Okay.
Shut the fuck up.
I know he's in it. Oh, he's obviously a time agent.
Yeah.
Come on.
I think this is my least favorite title coming up. The Legend of Ruby Sunday. Upgrade or delete?
Delete that shit out of here. Delete. Come on, man. We already got the church on Ruby Road.
You know, I know everyone hates when they give, like, golden showers to Doctor Who companions, right? And, like, they like, love them. I don't know if that analogy works
golden
at all.
Golden showers?
That's not what I meant.
All right, Trump.
But you know, like, when they put, like, companions on pedestals, everyone complains about Clara being the impossible girl, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
I don't have the biggest problem with that, except the way they word it. I don't mind if Clara's the center of the plot, but let's just stop going around and going, she's the impossible girl, blah, blah, blah. And I think the Legend of Ruby Sunday...
A little too high.
Shut the fuck up. I think the Legend of Ruby Sunday does exactly that, where it's just a bit wanky.
Well, you know it's going to be some bullshit about it. It's like, if you didn't have a mother or father, then how are you born? If it was you who delivered the baby, that was you.
Bum.
If it's you in the cloak delivering you, how does
that
work?
Just that Spider-Man meme of the Spider-Man pointing to each other, but it's Ruby Sunday.
What is this? Some kind of Legend of Ruby Sunday? Yeah, I think it's wanky. Does Russell even care anymore about these titles? He's
no.
Like, the Legend of Ruby Sunday. That's great. We'll run with that.
The giggle.
It's like, the Starbeast is literally fucking from the comic name. Wild Beyond is great.
Yeah. And the giggle I don't mind because it is all about that giggle. That is like a big part of the plot. But, yeah.
So silly when we first heard that. We're like, the giggle.
The giggle.
What a load of shit.
The finale, finishing on a bit of a higher note. I'm going to upgrade Empire of Death. I think that's a bit better of one.
Sure. I don't know what it means.
Yeah.
I'll upgrade it. It's definitely better than the Legend of Ruby Sunday. And we're assuming they're two-parters, so...
I guess it's just like a bit generic and vague. Almost like every second episode of Doctor Who could be called Empire of Death. Do you know what I mean? Except by the looks of these trailers, it looks like this planet's dying and there's like all that smoky stuff. Oh, we've already
done that. Enough of that bullshit. It's like, yeah, I bet it's just shitty rewatching the Flux again. Like, my God. So you had half deletes and half upgrades. I think I had maybe one more delete than you.
Yeah.
And so you're half and half at least.
Yeah.
You're 50-50 on the titles.
I originally had more deletes in there, but I suppose I've come to terms with...
You want it to be nice.
Yeah. I don't want to be nice. I don't want to be too angry. But yeah. All right. Con.
Can I quickly ask you if...
Yeah, man.
I don't know. I guess that is what we're talking about next. How do you feel about there only being two other writers?
Yeah, okay, let's jump into that, shall we?
Sorry, I didn't even think about
that. No, we'll just jump around the run sheet. No fucking problem. Is Russell T. Davies writing too many episodes? Because he writes six, and then you have one by Moffat, and then you have one by... is it Kate?
The two Disney ladies.
From Loki.
That's some low-key shit right there.
boy. You're very funny. Yeah, funny so Russell looking. Only writes six, and then you have Kate Herron Kate Harron co-writing with one of her writer friends.
Isn't it a beautiful lady who's also directing it?
I'll
look that up as you talk. I can do that now. I've got a laptop.
I know. Look how professional we look today. I would have loved one or two more new writers. Another reason why I think maybe Moffat is coming in a season too early is because you know, that's a spot that could go to some new blood. But at the end of the day, like, I'm not jumping to no conclusions about this season, you know? Who's writing it is not going to make me hate it, unless it was, like, written by fucking Noel Clark or some shit like that, you know?
Noel Clark!
Like, all right. Like, as long, like, I don't...
Co-off King.
As long as they are, like, good episodes, like, I don't really care who writes them. And I'm glad Moffat's back.
My bad, sorry. The director of Devil's Core directs Rogue. I thought...
Ben Chisel.
Okay, I thought it was... Oh, that's because Kate Herron is an English director and writer, so she is a director.
Yeah, she was a director on Loki.
I would have loved to have seen her direct it.
Yeah, well. Imagine a written and directed by...
Because we've never had that, have we?
Oh, mate. Never
had that.
Oh, I'd that's love it.
That's a big missed opportunity.
Oh, this just gets me so excited.
I already had Benny Boyd do Devil's Core. So it's Julie Ann Robinson, who does episode one.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's Ben... Chesel, who does episode two, that was called, and Rogue. Julie Ann also does Boom. Dylan Holmes does 73 Yards and Dot and Bubble.
Mm-hmm.
And Jamie does two finales. Yeah.
And just following up on that, so Kate Herron and Bryony Redman are the writers of Rogue.
Yeah, baby.
So yeah, I would like some more fresh blood, but it does not by any mean ruin the season. I don't have a problem with Russell writing most of the season. You know, it's... Most miniseries or just series in general are written by a singular writer a lot of the time now. Russell's used to working like that lately.
Yeah, we kind of theorized that was going to be the case, didn't we?
Let's get some fresh blood in season two. But
I agree.
You know, I ain't mad about it.
Chibi did so much in season one.
Chibnall?
Yeah.
I mean, he did so much in his third season.
He did a lot in all of them, to be fair.
He did.
Yeah.
But this is, I guess, slightly next level stuff. But also, Russell wrote, I think, seven episodes in series one, which was obviously a 13-episode season, so that was more time for more other writers. I said a lot on this. Do you have anything else to say on it?
I think it's crazy that it's going to be... There's some ridiculous number, like over 3,000 days, because Rogue's going to be the first episode in a very, very long time. That's going to be written by someone who's not a head writer.
I think it was like 1,500.
1,500.
3,000 is a long time. That's like...
Listen, folks, I ain't...
That's like 12 years.
That's 12 years, sorry. That's like 3 years since... God, it must have been in Chibnall's era, the last...
Haunting of Villa Diodati was the last one. It was
the Haunting of Villa Diodati.
To not have a showrunner attached to the writing.
And that's weird, because that Rogue's been kind of compared to Haunting of Villa Diodati with all the costumes and stuff.
I guess it's got that Regency vibe to it.
So, yeah, that's... I think that's cool. It's girl power. I'm there for it.
And directed by a man.
Yeah, that's kind of weird, but...
No, it's not. It's not weird.
It is weird. But, just get her to direct as well. I don't
know. Oh, no, that would have been awesome. Like, yeah, that would have been sick. Yeah. But
sorry for not being weird, Aiden.
No, I thought... I thought you were like, it's weird that a man's directing an episode.
Well, no, I think it's weird that, you know, it's a ladies episode and...
I don't know. I don't know what the episode's about, so I can't comment on...
Are they just no lady directors who want to work at the BBC.
Is there? Surely there's some lady directors direct. Were they all
there
men?
There is. It was Julianne.
Yeah, Robinson. There you go. Yeah, so we're fine.
Where was fucking Julie on that day? Too busy directing Boom by Stephen Moffat.
Well, to be honest, I'd rather, unless there's something specific about the plot, I'd rather, like, you know, we're all about, like, mixing up perspectives and stuff. So having, like a male writer and female director is better than having a male writer and a male director. These aren't rules to live by. I'm just saying I'm not mad when multiple genders are working together on one episode. Is
I think it's a missed opportunity.
It would have been great. Oh, it would have been great. And I'm not bagging on that by no means.
Also, it would have made headlines that Loki director directing an episode of Doki Who. Again, maybe she was too busy or felt the pressure, folks. You know, but I don't know. I just thought it would have been cool.
Missed opportunity.
Sure, a missed opportunity.
New trailer, though. Yeah.
Get
some quick thoughts out there on that, Connor. I like this a lot more than the first one. First trailer I liked. Second trailer, I loved. I thought, pretty colors everywhere I look. I was like, wow, whoa. This shit is hot as fuck.
Yeah.
Love to see it. Quick shout out to the music in there. You know, it's kind of generic action-y stuff at the start, but then about halfway through the trailer, it moves into like this 2000s house party music, which just like goes off. Do you know what I mean by that?
It's like, goodbye, Joe Bowie. Hello, house music.
Let's fucking go. And I loved it a lot. I felt like the trailer was a lot more tailored to me and audiences that are already familiar with the concept of Doctor Who. So like most people in the UK know that Doctor Who is a time travel show about a man in a box. In a box. Whereas like the Disney Plus trailer had to be a lot more like, this is what happens in Doctor Who. It's a time machine. This is who the Doctor is.
That's why I didn't go upload. Sorry, Jesus. That's why I didn't go upload to Disney Plus.
The new one?
Yeah, the new trailer.
Yeah, I feel like this new trailer was definitely more for like an English audience.
Why it didn't go upload to that.
Okay. Already slightly more familiar with Doctor Who, whereas the Disney Plus one was a bit more of like a, here is the global introduction to Doctor Who, was my thought.
All right, go off, King.
And then fucking Space Babies. We can talk about Space Babies in a second. But yeah, give me some more thoughts.
Yeah, this is... I didn't think I'd like it as much as the first trailer, but I like it more.
Mm.
And I really like... I think I like the first trailer more than you did.
Yeah.
What is wrong with me today? Jesus,
I'm
sorry.
Dying.
I think I like the trailer more than I did than the first one, which I didn't think I would. It's longer. I think it's definitely paced better than the first trailer.
Yeah, and that was a big problem for me with the first trailer.
Yeah, it's funny. Once you said that, I kind of stuck in my head with the first one. And I do agree with that.
Yeah.
But I think there's like this dark shift like halfway through the trailer.
Mm.
And I think it looks fantastic. There's literally like that scene where there's smoke going through like London and you see Mel and the Doctor. That literally looks like it's from like a movie.
Yeah, it looks great.
Like you could see that in like a Marvel trailer or something and you wouldn't be none the wiser. It looked fantastic. Mm-hmm. I'm waiting to show my family. I showed them the first one. They loved it. So I'm like, I'm waiting for the right moment to show them the second one. So I'm like, yeah, this is good shit. I think it's a good trailer to show people to get them excited.
Mm-hmm.
I was on the wine tour on the weekend and people were like, you know, I want to get into it. And I was like, do it. Now's the perfect time to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And even if you start here and then go back, sure. And sure.
Do you know what I loved as well? Was I feel like we've got very accustomed to like second trailers showing at least like 50% of the content from the first trailer. This felt like all new stuff. Like obviously there's a few repeated
there's
shots
a few
in
things,
there and stuff.
But it's not.
But it felt
bad.
It just felt like a completely different trailer. And even though they're only a week apart, I still really welcome that. And I still feel like we don't know much about these episodes. You know?
There's a lot you don't know about.
Hmm.
Like, Space Babies and Mystery. I think we know a lot about Devil's Court. Boom. We don't really know anything about.
Yeah,
73 Yards, nothing. Dondor, nothing. Rogue, pretty much nothing. The final... There's no villain leak or
no,
anything.
You just kind of gather that dust thing is killing planets or something like that.
It's the flux.
It's literally the flux.
It's literally the flux. The flux hit London.
But Devil's Court's the only one we know. I mean, we don't even know a lot about it. We just know like Beatles, like Jinx Monsoon, probably a musical episode. And then now we know episode one is Space Babies. And
yeah,
and Space Babies in that.
Thank God nothing's really leaked. The name Devil's Court leaked and all that shit. And, and it was rumored for at least a year that Stephen Moffat was doing an episode about a landmine. And then that came true. But apart from that,
Can I get some thoughts on Space Babies?
I'm not... Sorry.
Just in general, not the
episode.
Sorry,
Babies out. Well, I haven't seen it. You fuckhead. It's out next month. I'll give you my full thoughts when it drops on Disney.
I mean, irrelevant to Doctor Who. Can you just talk about the idea of babies being in space?
What a fucking stupid idea. They're babies. Yeah. I live at home with a 2-year-old. It's not easy.
Do you like them with adult voices? Or
no,
not,
but, I hate the... I can't wait to see my dad's eyes roll to the back of his head and me be in the back like... Ugh. No, I think it's fucking stupid. I saw the title they released, like with the little footage, it was like 5 seconds. It went do-do-do with the lights in it, like you hear a baby crying, you see the monster from the trailer.
That was
kind of
cool. I
like
that.
I thought that sold me. I was like, yeah, that's amazing. And I see... I was like, I didn't know... I thought the space baby was going to be like a name maybe Shooty gave to the creatures to give them maybe a bit of a sweeter name. It's like they look horrible, right, and disgusting, they're scary. But he's like, don't worry, just think of them as space babies. I thought it was going to be something like that. And then I watched the trailer, and I see, and I'm like, oh, I see.
I kind of like...
It's literally space babies. Give me a fucking break.
I kind of like the idea of it being like a nursery in space, and there's like a monster on the loose fucking
it's
eating babies.
It's probably
going to
be that.
But...
can they do that, though? Can they have a fucking monster eating babies?
A, can they do that? B, I think in the background, because I did my trailer breakdown, which you should check out.
I haven't watched that yet. I really need to.
I think in the background of a couple shots, it looks like they're growing babies in jars. So I don't know what the fuck's going on there. Nice. But like, there's that shot of Ruby looking out, like it's like parallels to End of the World. And in the side of the shot, you can see like babies in tanks that look like they're maybe being grown. And C, if it is just babies being eaten by a monster... Isn't that literally just the plot of The Church on Ruby Road?
So that's the thing. It's like there must be some kind of... Is there a link to fucking Bubs?
Bubs?
Does Russell just love fucking...
He hates kids. Does he just fucking hate kids?
What's the connection with the fucking babies? We just had it.
Well, we know Ruby's good with kids. Maybe it's like Russell's... Because I think we're all assuming that episode one is sort of a... another new jumping on point.
Right.
I think maybe it's a way of Russell again introducing Ruby's orphanage? Yeah, Ruby being like a foster child is what I'm trying to say.
I wanna know. True. So there's also an actress that's been announced that it's going to be in episode one.
Mm.
And she's from Bridgerton, is it? Well, so Russell D. Davis says it's been amazing to see the whole wide world appreciate Goldest Hands because of Bridgerton, and it's been an absolute joy to invite her to Cardiff to help launch Shooty and Millie's first season.
What was her name, sorry?
So Julianne Robinson directed Space Babies in Golda Rochalu. She's in Queen Charlotte, a Bridgerton story.
Who joins Doctor Who
as Jocelyn.
Hold on, is there Bridgerton spin-offs now? Charlotte, a Bridgerton story.
Oh my Bridgerton.
Oh, there is a Bridgerton spin-off called Rogue.
Yeah. This is so Bridgerton.
This is so Bridgerton. Oh,
I don't know how I feel about that shit, but...
I'm not against it. I think it's fucking trendy, I guess.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think it is a Bridgerton spin-off. Yeah, I think it... So yeah, it's a Bridgerton spin-off. Okay, cool. So she's from that. Okay, this is a big actress in a Netflix show.
Mm-hmm.
She might be the lady who is looking after all the space babies, okay?
Space mother.
I ain't keen on that, but I guess we'll see. Seriously, after I saw that, I'm like, oh, thank God we got Devil's Court after that, which I didn't think I would be saying
and we
a
get
few
them
weeks ago.
Back to back.
Exactly.
So
I didn't think I'd be saying that a few weeks ago.
Might just skip Space Babies and go straight to Devil's Court.
I haven't seen it.
It's going to be the classic case with Doctor Who whenever we're like, oh, you know, you can jump on at this point, but maybe just like skip this episode and do this. It's going to be the classic case of like...
But this episode what? Nah, it doesn't
matter. just jump straight to Devil's Court. Don't worry about...
I know, that's what scares me. It's a risky maneuver with the name and the... Bubs in it.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, come on. It's a little bit risky.
I'm not good with kids.
I'm not good with children.
Connor, we've had a lot of fun today talking about space babies and all sorts of Doctor Who-y new stuff, but I think it's time we jump back to the 70s and jump back to the horror of Fang Rock.
Okay.
Okay. You sound very excited to talk about the horror of Fang Rock.
Yeah, let's go. I'm very keen.
I mean, we're doing it because season 15 came out and you said you've always wanted to do it, Horror Fang Rock. So
I've always wanted to do Horror Fang Fuck, yeah.
The Horror of Thank Fuck is the first serial of the 15th season of the British science fiction television series Doctor Who, first broadcast in 4 weekly parts on the BBC One from the 3rd to the 24th of September 1977. The serial is set on the fictional English island of Thank Fuck. in the early 20th century, where a shape-shifting alien, scout called a Rutan, arrives on Earth, intending to use the planet as a strategic place in the Rutans' war against the Sontarans.
What a plot twist.
It's directed by Patty Russell and written by Terrence Dix.
My boy, Mr. Dix. Okay, now, what a fucking plot twist.
Before we get into the episode, I just want to say one fucking thing, okay?
What is it?
Rutans?
Yeah.
Dollar store Zygons, am I right? What the fuck's going on there?
Yeah, explain yourself.
Zygons are just like shape-shifting motherfuckers. Isn't this what Rutans are doing?
Ah.
Then they just shape-shift into old mate?
I don't know much about the Rutans except the Doctor mentioned them in, I think, Poison Sky. Because they're the ones who beef with... Ooh, they're the ones who beef with the Sontarans heaps. They're the ones who had the big war with the Sontarans.
Mm-hmm.
So, what a fucking... I loved the plot. I was like... You're who?
Oh, you didn't know it was the Rutans?
No, that's what I'm saying. I'm glad I didn't read this because when it got real, I'm like, the Rutans, they're those little fuckers that fight the Sontarans.
I think, and once again, this is me just making up classic Who lore because I know nothing.
Okay.
I think this is the only time the Rutans are in the show.
Right, I was going to ask you that.
I think so. I can fact check that in as we speak.
Okay.
I'd never seen this one before. I'd obviously heard a lot about it being really good.
Wait, you've never seen it?
No, well, because I watched the new episodes in the classic, in the collection
of
sets.
Of course.
So I'd never seen this one because this set is brand new. So as soon as I got it, I dove straight into it.
Oh, I see.
Always love getting these sets. I've almost finished The Invisible Enemy now, which is the next story, which introduces K-9.
The Invisible Enemy?
Yeah, it's the story after this. But, yeah, so we have the Doctor on fucking Fang Rock, mate. Mm. Yeah, I was keen for it. I knew it was horror vibes. You were keen for it.
Yeah, well, I think I was very keen for it for two reasons. One, my fantastic video that's coming out.
Mm-hmm.
That will be out by the time this comes out.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, the...
Oh, well, it's going to come out a few days after this comes out, I think.
A day after this.
Yeah.
But let's just say for sake, it's out already. For view's sake. The idea of it being set... So my favorite movie is The Lighthouse.
Mm-hmm.
And I just, there's something about stormy, seaweed, nighttime, lighthouses.
Claustrophobia.
Fog, creepy vibes that I love. So seeing it in a Doctor Who episode.
Sailors.
Nah. Just, yeah, sailors, mm-hmm. seamen, you know,
mm-hmm.
old seabirds, sea dogs.
Sea doggies.
You know, yeah, bad luck to kill a seabird, so... yeah, very, very. It does say here, yeah, they're only in the horror fan rock and in the Doctor Who Adventure.
Yeah,
games.
I was about to say that. Yeah,
and it literally says
Matt
here,
Smith's one, I think.
It literally says here, it's like the Zygons, Rutans can shapeshift. Mm-hmm. So it's like, yeah, even
knock off
Wiki.
Knock off fucking Zygons, mate.
Yeah.
Do you want my opinion first or your opinion first?
You go first. You go first, I go first. You go first.
Okay. I think this is a really solid story. I think it's good. I think. I don't know if maybe the hype got to me a little bit too much on this one. Because, I mean, broad strokes, I think tonally this episode is amazing. And it has like one of the best tones in Classic Who. Because sometimes a lot of Classic Who, it's all shot with like the whole studio system where everything's flat. This episode uses a lot of like shadows, lighting things with backlight to actually create a really interesting atmosphere, which I think is really good. And... you know, going alongside that, the production design, the sound design, everything creates a genuinely spooky atmosphere for an episode. And the claustrophobia, like what we were saying, trapped in a lighthouse.
Well said.
I can see why it left an impact for any, you know, young guns watching it in the 70s. I do think you get a lot of, we're just going up and down the lighthouse. Like, we're just going up and down. And sometimes when a plot is slightly too simple, I get confused because I'm like, what have I missed? Because it's all just like, we're going up the top, we're going back down, we're going up, we're going down. And I love the slow burn nature of it, but I couldn't help but feel like we went up and down that lighthouse way too many fucking times and accomplished not a lot until part four.
Okay.
But that being said, I did really enjoy it still. By no means up there as one of my favorite Classic Who stories. I think I will like it a lot more on rewatch.
Uh-huh.
But I suppose the best thing I can say about it is Towns of Rang Chiang is obviously a controversial episode of Doctor Who. And I love the tone of that story. I really wish it didn't come with so much baggage because I think if they had made some better decisions creating that story, it would be...
What series is that?
It's actually the story before this one, so the end of season 14.
Okay.
If it didn't have all that baggage attached and they made some better decisions creating it, I think that could have been one of the best episodes of Doctor Who of all time. And this episode has all that tone without the baggage of The Talents of Wen Chiang. All
right.
So that's a really good thing. Like, I think it carried on that spooky tone well. And they really... I think Philip Hinchcliffe was the producer at the time.
Right.
Script... No, Robert Holmes is who I'm trying to talk about.
Oh, boy.
Robert Holmes was the script editor at the time. And I think his vibe is all over this, and I like it a lot. What do you think of the horror of Fang Rock?
Okay, you ready for this?
Yeah.
A lot of hype going into this, Sam. Mm-hmm. I'm going to say this. This is probably top three Classic Who episodes for me.
You like this one?
Bro, I love this shit.
Good, man. I'm happy for you.
It's... I don't know. I think Survival still has number one, but it might take over Survival.
This is definitely better than Survival. Survival has like a nostalgic vibe, and there's something really cool about it. I love
that's what good pussy. You are half cat, and a man's allowed to experiment. No,
that's what good pussy sounds like. That's what good. That's a vine, right?
That's sure. Whatever you say.
Yeah.
I fucking love it. Come on, man. The Lighthouse is my favorite movie. There's something about the creepy ass lighthouses I love, man. This is such a. I wish I'd watched it sooner.
Yeah,
I love it. I've really loved it. I think
I'm glad.
It's a dark story. It's creepy. It's claustrophobic. Everyone fucking dies except for the Doctor and Leela, and I love that.
That is crazy, isn't
they
it?
They all fucking die.
That is crazy.
All the lighthouse keepers die. I think there's four of them, or three of them, and this kind of like boat crashes along the way, which is kind of silly, but still. And they all fucking die.
Yeah, actually, everyone dies, don't they?
Everyone other than dies, the Doctor and Leela.
That's just crazy.
Leela loses the color of her eyes. They change to blue.
Yeah, which, by the way...
Sacrifices are made, which I don't think they continue on in
canon. I was watching The Invisible Enemy.
Are they blue?
And I was like, I can't tell the color of her eyes. I don't know what... Did she, like... Did she change the color of her eyes like Lala Ward?
It's too dark to see. I think even in the scene, like that's what I mean. It's like it's rocky. It's foggy. There's dead fish in the water.
Those
like,
scenes out there on the rocks is some of the best Classic Who has ever looked. I think that stuff is so atmospheric.
Great, and this is the kind of shit I love. I always say if you could have made like the perfect movie for me, it is The Lighthouse, and like if you could make the perfect episode of Doctor Who for me. It would be something like this.
Mm-hmm.
And I would kill for something like this in like New Who era.
Yeah.
But I think with the creepy vibe of it being like, it's all so old and it's in, you know, it's like, it's 4:3 aspect ratio. You know, it's like, it's all grainy. It suits it.
It all adds to it, doesn't it?
It all adds to it. And again, I know I was kind of, it might sound like I was memeing before, but the plot twist with the Rutons.
Mm-hmm.
I fucking loved, and I didn't know that, and I loved that.
Yeah.
It felt like there were consequences. I actually gave a shit about the lighthouse keepers. They actually had personalities. Yeah,
they were quite good, weren't they? I like the one that was giving me, like, Jamie vibes.
Yeah, it was Jamie vibes.
Yeah.
I do like the old sea dog, the... Like 30 years ago, a man went mad and the other two died.
Why is this almost your William Hartnell impression?
Oh, dear me, no.
I'm trapped in a lighthouse.
And like the rich fucks who crash, it's like they're rich and fucking shit.
Kill those dogs.
And they all die as well. I love how...
This episode seriously had a dog in it.
It was insane.
It was crazy shit.
There's a woman called Adelaide, and she gets treated so badly during this episode. Every time she sees someone die, she's like...
She faints.
No! And she's screaming and crying. And literally, at one point, one of the guys dies that she has, probably Lord Palmer Day or whatever his fucking name is. He literally dies, and she finds out and starts crying. And Leela's reaction to comfort her is to slap her.
Yes. I was going to bring this up.
And no one addressed it. It's like, and then she's like, oh my God. And gets slapped. And then no one talks about it.
Like, Leela just fucking smacks that shit.
And then 5 minutes later, they go downstairs and find another one of the dead lighthouse keepers. And then she's like on the stairs like, oh my God. And then the doctor's like, get her out of here. Get her out of here. I'm like, this is great. There's drama. There's tension. It's everything that I want in episode. And I remember putting on part one in the UK in 2016 with my Auntie Lorraine.
Right.
And 5 minutes in being like, the fuck is this shit? Turn it off. It's just this is so boring.
Now it's changed your mind.
Now what we like, God, 8 years later. Mm. I'll let you talk. But yeah, it to me, it's like everything I want in an episode and more.
I think I don't want to sound like I'm too negative on this episode because I think it is really, really, really good. And I think like it's so risky as well. Like just crazy decisions in this fucking episode.
Risque.
I think I really liked episode one. I felt like episode two and three maybe could have been condensed to one. But the only thing is if you start to cut down these episodes, you run the risk of getting rid of the spooky atmosphere and the real slow burn pacing of it.
Mm-hmm.
But I suppose maybe what I would have wanted is a little bit more of them just to keep that slow burn vibe up, to have more of them just like in rooms talking this stuff out rather than going up and down the lighthouse in and out of the lighthouse. Because it just felt a bit repetitive for me at times.
Yeah, it's like the basement, the main room and the top.
Yeah, and sometimes it was like, you know, we can just sit in a room and talk and the atmosphere will still be there. But I get it because they needed to get them out of the room at times so that the Rutan could go in and kill those motherfuckers and all that sort of thing. But yeah, I still think it's a really great episode. It's just not City of Death. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
You know? I think... Okay, here was a big thing for me that troubled me a few times in the episode. Was just the complete lack of chemistry between Tom and Lala.
Really?
Yeah, I thought until the final episode, I thought the first three episodes were just... Tom does this thing, and he doesn't really start off like this. And so I think jumping from season 12 to seeing this, when Liz isn't on the show anymore, you can see the difference.
Okay,
is that like he does this thing where he just does not look at the people he's talking to, and I don't mind it as a general rule. Like it's okay to have traits like that, like where he's often in his head and not thinking about, you know, human decency of, you know, making eye contact with the person you're talking to. But I found that there was just so many times in this episode where he should have been looking at Leela and he just wasn't and was stale and just always was giving her the shoulder and there was just all this stuff that I can't help sometimes but feel like a lot of, you know, the second half of Tom's run is slightly plagued for me by knowing just how difficult he could be sometimes. And I think this is still early on. I don't think this is when
so were there issues or
I know he wasn't that I know he's said on the record before that he didn't want a companion after Sladen left and that was an issue that carried on across all of his era. And so there's a notable shift in how he treats his companions after that. You can start working it into his character all you want, but I think for me it's like it has its foundation in the reality of the production. And so sometimes, and I know it shouldn't affect me that much, but sometimes it really does where I'm like, I don't like seeing the Doctor not being kind to his companions. And I think sometimes you get a bit of that in this episode.
Was it mainly arrogance?
I don't think I'm qualified enough to comment on that. I don't know.
Just got a bit of like, yeah, you know, he was like, I'm the star.
I'm going to throw fucking kettles at people's heads and shit.
That is true.
Yeah.
But
that's not till like season 18 and stuff. Like, I think he's still okay in this time. But
Why did he stay on, though, if he didn't want to do it?
I don't know.
Was the money just really good?
A lot of questions about this time.
Probably just good money.
It's a job. As Chris Eccleston said when he came back to do Big Finish, I'm an actor and I need to work.
It's a job and it's fucking COVID, yeah.
And I by no means want to be like I'm shitting on Tom Baker's legacy because Tom Baker is fucking incredible.
I thought he was so great in this.
And I think he is. I would just love it if he looked at his companions more in the eyes.
Has Louise Jameson, has she commented on that? Are they like friends?
They're friends now. I think they were a little bit iffy at the time. But I believe they're friends now.
So I've only seen Leela in Robot of Death.
Robots of Death, yeah.
Robots of Death. And I'm going to be honest, I enjoyed her in this episode a lot more. So she's a cave woman.
Yes. Okay. Well, yeah.
Is basically. That derogatory? Sorry.
No, I don't think so.
Okay. No. So she's a cave woman. And I do like how, particularly in the first episode, you do get the vibe that she's not... she's a bit uneducated on stuff.
Mm.
I like that. Mm-hmm. And I think I enjoyed her a lot more in this. Does she do 2 seasons or a season and a half?
Yeah, she joins halfway through season 14 and I think finishes at the end of season 15.
Right, and then it's Romana.
Yes, Romana 1, and then she regenerates into Romana 2, who you've seen.
There's 2 Romanas?
Romana regenerates, bitch.
Who the fuck's the first one?
Never seen an episode of her.
Are you serious? In my life.
I think she regenerates off screen as well.
Oh my god. Okay. That's going to be cool to watch.
Could be wrong about that as well, folks.
And 17's his last season, sorry?
18. 18 is, yeah.
So, and when he regenerates, who are his companions?
It's actually fucking crazy what happens. Because basically what happened was new showrunner John Nathan Turner takes the realms in season 18, okay? And you can definitely tell him seeding all the things that he wants to do once he gets his doctor. Once he gets rid of Tom Baker, basically.
Right. It's the end.
And so over the course of Tom's last 3 stories, Romana leaves in I think the 4th last one or something. Oh no. So there's a moment where it's Romana and Adric together for an episode or two.
That's it, Adric.
And then Romana leaves in the next week. And then the story after that, Nyssa joins, and then the story after that, Tegan joins, which is also the story that Tom regenerates in.
So Tegan is in a Tom Baker episode.
She's in Tom's final episode.
Holy shit.
So it's he then regenerates with 3 completely new faces around him.
Wow, okay.
It's fucking crazy.
So is Romana still out there as a character?
Yeah, she ends with K-9. They go off together, actually. And then somehow K-9's...
Then why the fuck's he with...
Don't question it.
Wow.
Don't question it.
So, but was she... Did she die in the Time War?
Don't know. I've got no answers.
Ask Nick Briggs. I'm hitting Josh up after this.
Ask Nick Briggs.
Did she die in the... Why would Nick Briggs know?
Because he would have written so many Big Finish stories for her.
Okay.
Romana, Time War leader. Time War leader.
The death of Romana. The Daleks, they're coming. Oh.
Romana 3.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So there was no sexual tension between Louise Jameson and Tom Baker, is what you're saying?
No, that doesn't come in until Romana 2. That's and Romana Tom 2. Baker.
Okay. Yeah. That is in fucking insane.
Yeah, it's crazy, isn't it? Okay. But no, Tom is really good in this. I just wish he would look at his fucking companion.
I think this was the first episode, and I know this is such a cliche to say, because it's the same shit our mums did with Matt Smith. They're like, I finally get it now, after seeing an episode.
Yeah.
But I think it was the scene when he was talking to the Rutom where I was like, I get it. I get
you
why.
Get the Baker hype?
I get the Baker hype.
Yeah, he's
I'm
great.
I'm like, shit.
He's great.
I get it now. You know, I'm like, I even watched the whole season with him and I was like, he is really good, but I don't know if I love him. Mm. Now I'm like, yeah, he really is fucking amazing.
I feel bad. I really don't mean to shit on Baker.
No,
my whole point is that
I know
there's certain stories where I can see that the chemistry isn't right there, and I can't help but start thinking about that behind the scenes stuff as I watch it. But
it's
he is really good.
Like Noel and John, it's hard to go back and watch those episodes now and be as enjoying of it.
There's always an element of it on your mind when you watch
that.
It.
Yeah. But I can't distract the art from the artist. And I know Tom's had a bit of shenanigans.
Hmm.
And I guess I'll see them. I have heard that from you and Josh, that his performance kind of dwindles a little bit near the end and he starts not really giving a fuck.
And there's definitely an element where you can start to intertwine it with his character. You kind of can, which is, I suppose, the only positive about it. But yeah, it almost feels like every new companion that comes on, he becomes less and less interested in them. And then Romana 2 comes on. They want to bang.
Mm.
And then they get a divorce. and then they don't want to bang. Fucking Tom's era, man.
It's not. So, yeah, that's it. So, is it canon-wise this doctor just lived a very long time?
Well, I suppose so. He did 7 seasons, yeah.
Okay.
Do you have many more thoughts on Fang Rock?
I just think it's, you know, it reminds, like, I wish I had, you know, I know people who get the box sets and they're so excited, and it's probably because they watched it, not necessarily because you didn't watch it when it was airing, but it's like, I do understand why people get these box sets and they're extremely excited to rewatch episodes. I wish I had this kind of hype going into every ep. But it's like, if we're comparing this to, like, what was it, Revenge of the Cybermen we did,
mm-hmm.
our last classic episode, which I thought was a horrendous piece of fucking dog shit. This is like, this, if I could go into every episode being excited like this,
mm-hmm.
I'd be a very happy boy.
Yeah. Yeah, I want to give a shout out to the sound design.
Brilliant.
Particularly the score by Dudley Simpson. Great job. That my only thing would be, in episodes 1 and 2, he repeats the same, like, bomb bomb sound so many times that it drove me insane, but I think upon the whole it sounds really great.
Yeah, it's also had a big finish adaptation.
What, Return to Fang Rock or something? Thank fuck we're on Fang Rock.
Thank
fuck for Fang Rock.
Doctor Who and the Horror of Fang Rock by Terrence Dix.
Oh, it's had a you're talking about a Target novel.
Did I say Big Finish?
You said Big Finish.
My bad.
I was like, what are you on about?
That's the hard solos hitting me. Sorry.
It's had a Target novel. Yeah, well, every classic Who has a Target novel written for it.
There's one for Revenge of the Sidemen.
There's one for Revenge of the Sidemen.
Every episode?
Every episode.
You're fucking with me.
No, man. Every single one.
Are you serious?
That's why all the new ones are just new Who ones, because they've done one for every classic
Who
episode.
Are you joking?
I mean, we know what I'm like. My facts can be wrong. They regularly are. But I'm pretty certain that everyone has a classic Who story.
I thought it was just for, like, well-acclaimed episodes.
No, every single fucking one, mate.
And is it because it's this? So the Target novel was by Terrence Dix. So is that kind of normal that the writer would write the?
Yeah, obviously it's not always the case, particularly with New Who now, with Stephen Moffat having written 100 billion episodes
mm-hmm.
and counting.
yeah.
I think Moffat wrote the Day of the Doctor one. I don't think we'll get many more from him outside of that. And same with Russell, he did the Rose one. And that was like I think they came out at the same time, those Target novels.
Yeah, they did interviews together, yeah.
And so that was like a cool thing to do. Definitely not Russell with what he's doing at the moment.
Yeah.
See them writing.
That's why he didn't do the 60th ones. All Church Movie Rose.
Yeah, exactly. He had the chance there too. And yeah. So yeah, now quite often they're written by different writers, but you know, you've seen, like, I started reading What Was the Master Today, 50 pages into that, good stuff. Ford came back to write that, Philly, which is Ford. Great.
Yeah, that's, I have read, that's the one Tartan novel I've read.
I think Joy Wilkinson did the Witchfinders one, Pete McTighe's Kablam one is there, which I have on the shelf, haven't read yet.
Maybe keep it on there.
So I think they try and get them back as much as they can, but it's not always the case.
So funny. It says part one here got 6.8, part two got 7.1, three got 9.8, and four got 9.9.
The homies were loving Fang Rock.
Why? You never see this. It normally drops, not rises.
Mm-hmm.
Normally part one always has the biggest.
Didn't in season 7, Stephen Moffat said, we're doing all single parters because if you look at all the stats, part twos always get less views. So mm-hmm. that's why season 7 was all single parters. And then the motherfucker went on to do season 9, where every episode's a two-parter.
Yeah, how did that end up for you, Stephen? I do want to mention just real quick, yeah, the Max Headroom hacking.
Sure, yes, this is what your video is going to be
about. That's
what
my video is going to be about, so I won't go too much into it. But yeah, on the 22nd of November 1987,
mm-hmm.
at the Chicago television station WTTW, yeah, it was hacked by a pirate broadcast featuring an unknown individual, and they never caught the people who did it. And that was in part one of Fang Rock. So it was so cool watching, because I've watched that video 1,000 times of the hacking. It was so cool watching the scene, and I knew when it cut off.
What does it cut to again?
It's like a guy in a mask.
Tune into Connor's video to find out.
Oh, yeah, that is true. I'm doing a whole video on it. It's very exciting. But yeah, it scared the living daylights out of people. But it's so, to me, it's so fitting now of watching, have watched Horror Fang Rock. It's so fitting to have that, mm-hmm. I think, that it had that happen to this episode. They didn't pick Doctor Who specifically. I think it just happened to be airing at the time they hijacked the network.
Yeah.
But
it happened to be a spooky fucking episode.
It sure did, sir. It sure did.
Not a massive amount to say on this one, because I think it is a lot of just going up and down the lighthouse and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
So, Connor, unless you have anything more to say, do you want to give me your final rating for The Horror of Fang Rock out of 10?
Alright, fuckers, get ready for this.
Oh, God, I'm scared.
Nine? I love it, baby.
Damn, boy, you give me
wait,
a
what
9?
Wait, what did I give? I gave 9 to Survival.
Hold on, let me have a look. Let me go through the tabs here. Survival, you gave a 9. So that
can
stacks
I give
up.
Horror of Fang Rock a 9.1?
A 9? Yeah, you can.
I think it's going to take my top place.
It's your favorite classic horror story. Okay.
It is my favorite classic horror story. This is just so made for me.
I am going to give it a 7.5.
Wow.
For me. Big fan of it. That's an A.
The difference in ratings.
That's an A for me. 7.5 is an A, and anything more than that is an A+. Because I think it's a cracker.
Sad.
I think it's so well made and all that. I just... There were just times where I was like, okay, we're still doing this. And I love... You know me. I love slow burn shit. So it's nothing to do with that kind of pacing. It's like there's a difference between like something being slow paced and something just treading too much familiar ground, which I think sometimes Horror Fang Rock did.
This is one of those episodes for me, like The Three Doctors, like Survival. Maybe you'll disagree with Survival, but that I could just show, I think, someone who's not a kind of classic fan of classic Who.
Flaccid Who?
Flaccid Who. Some might call the era that. And you can just watch it and actually maybe just enjoy it. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not Revenge of the Cybermen, difficult to get through. Like, it's just good.
Yeah, it is good.
And that's all I got to say about that.
Fair dues. Next week, about 8 of you will be in luck. Because we're going to jump back to Sarah Jane Adventures.
What the fuck ever happened to Sarah Jane?
What the fuck happened to Sarah Jane?
That's what it's called, isn't it? Whatever happened to Sarah Jane?
Well, we've gone from the horror to...
a month already?
The horror of thank fuck to going... fucking where the fuck Sarah Jane? No, we're prematurely going back to Sarah Jane Adventures purely because we have a new season of Doctor Who coming up, and we want to get through season one of Sarah Jane before that. So all 8 of you that watch those are going to be really excited. The other few hundred of you that don't turn up for those ones, maybe just turn up because
yeah, what are you doing?
We'll make sure. Here's what we got to do. Here's our pitch to you. Is that we need to spice up those episodes and talk about more than just Sarah Jane those episodes so that you guys get more out of it. Because if you're not that into Sarah Jane, you don't turn up for those episodes. We got to do something to shake that up. Otherwise, those Sarah Jane pod episodes will die a death.
I remember when we did the Ice Warriors review, which I notoriously watched and loved. You put the 60th anniversary trailer breakdown on it first. I thought you were going to do that for the Series 1 trailer, like Series 1 trailer breakdown and the Warriors of Colour Light review.
Well,
you did that for
I will do that for this episode, but I didn't.
Bit fucking late now.
Yeah, sorry about that one, guys.
That probably would have helped a little bit.
So yes, it will be whatever the fuck happened to Sarah J next week, mm-hmm. and then the week after that. I think we crack in and do a season 2 because we said we do season 2 next. So
yeah, it's time to hit season 2.
So we'll do season 2, and then I don't think we'll get through much of season 2 before season 1 comes out.
I was going to say, so it's Thursday the 4th now, so. This time next week on the 11th, we can say it's literally a month till the
season. Yes. One, well, that's on the recording dates of these episodes, not the dates that they come out.
Yes. Yeah, so, yeah, on the 11th will be, yeah.
Yeah.
A month till next week when we record on the Thursday, it'll be a month till season 1.
Exciting times, baby.
And we know it's going to go quick.
It will.
Get ready for episode predictions, reviews, lives.
There'll be so much coming
on
out.
Air fights.
Because what you don't understand is that is a time where we have to cash in on your addiction to Doctor Who. Mm. Whereas right now, there's none of that going on.
Dude, the subs are dropping like flies.
The last 2 weeks has been the most me just like shoveling my shit into this as possible. Where it's like, we've just been staying alive the last 2 weeks in terms of like doing the Zoom episodes and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But I think as of this week, we're fucking back.
Yeah.
I think we're back and we start ramping up this week.
I'm glad it's nearly a month till new episodes come out, because I did say to you today on the car ride that the next 3 weeks are going to be fucked for me. So if anyone does watch my lives, I will try my best to do them still, but I'm a tired man. I will try my best. I know people really like them and it seems to get the same viewership as like the main show, which is really nice, isn't it? I know people want to have like an extra show a week, so if that helps. I know it means a lot to people, I will try and do it, but also I know you understand this. I'm just a I'm just a man. I always do them after work.
Yeah. Maybe I could jump in if you have a busy week.
If you have the wants. I don't want to feel like it's just my
thing. I mean, just hit me up. If you're like, I can't do it this week, hit me up and I'll try.
Sure. No, if you have the want to
probably
do
won't
it,
be at the same day, but that's fine. Like,
yeah. No, if I you have the want to. I'm not trying to, it's not just my thing. Yeah. Everyone's always saying, we miss Aiden.
Bring back Aiden.
Yeah, bring back Aiden.
Oh, stop.
They say it.
Love
they
you
do.
Guys.
They
stop.
Do. They're like, where's Aiden? I'm like, I don't know.
Well, you've developed that connection through your lives with a lot of the listeners, I think. I see it in the comments. I'm like, oh, they like Connor. They like Connor.
Everyone loves you, man. That's fine.
Everyone loves you. Why can't they just love both of us?
They do love both of us.
They love us. Stop loving us so much.
It's not your fault. It's just I'm more of the reply person, and you don't necessarily reply as much as me.
Mm.
I do try to reply DMs. I know that's not really your thing, and that's fine. It doesn't have to be.
Yeah, I don't reply. Sorry, a lot of the times on Twitter, I don't reply. I will,
and that's fine.
I will often read the note, the message.
I
but
read them.
Won't reply.
Yeah.
And it's not, and I've not opened the message. You know what I'm saying? Like, I get the notification, I swipe it away.
That's nice. Yeah.
And then I think I better get back to them at some point. Yeah. Swipe away.
That's fine.
And then I don't think about it again. Often it's just, and that's just me.
That's just how you are, and that's fine.
Don't change me. You know?
Don't try and change me, baby.
It's Aiden's
and Connor
podcast. Doctor Who reviews. Doing Doctor Who reviews. Yeet. I'm excited for some bloody spag bowl, mate. I'm going upstairs.
Yeah, I don't know what I've got at home.
Go eat some fucking spaghetti and meat.
I'm keen to just relax and yeah. Just fucking chill the fuck out.
I might even watch some Sarah Jack. I think tonight
I might do the same.
My nan's over from the UK at the moment, so I'm going to sit with her for a bit. But Nana later tonight, Green. I think I either watch Sarah Jane, the next episode's fucking What the Fuck Happened to Sarah Jane Smith, bro.
Great episode. The Trickster's first episode.
Or Wobble Yonder.
Why don't you show your nan Wobble Yonder?
She'll be like, what the fuck's going on?
You're like, you having trouble sleeping? Come watch this.
Come watch some giant CGI limbs.
5 minutes in. Too slow for me.
We'll see you next week, folks.
Next week.